worry that you would be mindful of us. What do you see that's worth looking away? We are free in ways that we never should be. Sweet relief from the grip of the chains.
Let all your chains fall off this morning.
Oh yeah, I can just strain from the weight. My heart no longer can keep from singing. All that is within me cries, for you alone be glorified, Emmanuel, God with us. Don't deserve your glory. Still, you show a love we cannot afford. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you know our hearts don't deserve your glory. But still, you show we cannot afford. You paid the price, all the weight of our sin, yeah. Like hinges straining from the weight, my heart no longer can keep from singing. All that is within me cries, you alone.
Such a tiny offering, oh, compared to Calvary. Nevertheless, oh God, we lay it at your feet, God, yeah. Oh, singing all that is within me cries, for you. These chains are gone, Emmanuel, God with us.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Good morning. We are here at Creekside Community Church, and we are here to worship the Lord. And that's what we want to do. That's all our heart. Christ. We just thank you for tuning in this morning. A few things throughout the week. We are online plugging in. Every day of the week at 5, Pastor Mark will be online giving his devotional, except for Wednesday, we do our live at 5 worship service. And then we rest on the weekend, and then we're back here on Sunday mornings to join you guys online in worship with this amazing group. We're lucky to have Kyle Thurman here with us today. He's one of my best friends, and I just love that we get to worship together. We have a special word from Pastor Mark today, so we just thank you so much for tuning in. We're going to continue in worship today. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Oh, I'm forgiven. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Oh, it's love, yeah. Amazing, amazing love. How can it be that you, my King, would die for me? It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, amazing love. How can it be? Should my King would die? Joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you. Jesus, you are my King. There's power. Jesus, you are my King. Sing his name. Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you. Die for me. And
amazing love. I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do. Let me honor you in all I do. I honor you. In the darkness we were waiting, without hope and without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
Great.
first, you're the last, you're forever. You're the one who brings spring out of winter. You're the promise and you are the keeper. You're the one who holds all things together. In my grieving, in your sorrow, will your goodness steady me? When I'm blinded, when I'm hopeless, will I have the eyes to see? Yeah. You're the first, you're the last, you're forever. You're the one who brings spring out of winter. You're the promise. Trust the Father sees when you call me. Will I listen? Will I follow where you lead? I will follow where you lead.
Lord, we just thank you for this time. We thank you that in the midst of separation, you hold us together, Lord. Thank you for that truth. Thank you for the tools that you've given us to connect, Lord. But beyond being present on social media and having a bunch of views, and we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for connectivity and growth. But Lord, we just thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your kindness that determines who we are, Lord. Your word and your heart towards us, that has the final say of our value. Lord, I just pray that everyone listening to this right now would see their created intended value. Lord, that when you sent your son to die for us, that calls the shots. You have the final say on your children. Lord, just let us hear that. Because until we come to that place, Lord, of realization of our created value that you originally intended for us, Lord, we'll be lost. But we're not. Lord, we thank you for that. We praise you. That's why we gather. That's why we're together. Just open our hearts to this word. Speak through Mark this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Mikey. Great set, praise team. Kyle, great to see you as always. Thanks for, kind of funny seeing you on bass. Yeah, you're in the back, but you're holding down the bottom line. Man, I just love our praise team. I love their hearts to lead us to the throne of God. They make my job a little easier, setting me up. I love that song, Together. Good morning, church, out there in the digital world of social media. I'm so glad to have, we have a lot of people joining us. We've had new people join us, and we've got a lot going on, as Mikey D said. So we want to invite you to check out all our content, as he said, during the week. We're definitely here, as you're experiencing, 10 o'clock on Sundays. You can also check us out on our YouTube channel, 6 o'clock tonight. Some people, you know, that's the cool thing about this social media is you can catch it. It's always archived on our Facebook Live site. So you could have a 2 p.m. worship service with your family at home, or you could have a 6 p.m. or 8 p.m. And that's kind of cool and flexible and kind of great for families. Also, if you'd like to learn more about us, we're a 4-year revitalized church plant. You can go to cometocreekside.com, cometocreekside.com, say that 3 times fast, and you can find our statement of beliefs and what we are all about and see some of our leaders and our heart for the community here. So I do want to talk about together, especially now in the state of Arkansas. We're waiting for our governor, Asa Hutchinson, we're waiting for a new word about the reopenings of everything. At first was May 4th, and now I believe I read that some restaurants are doing soft reopenings on the 11th. We have some people here that are glad the hair salons are reopening. That's a beautiful thing, pardon the pun. Okay, some of you need to be beautiful, me included. But prior to this, I guess in the last 2 weeks, the phrase that I've heard and I've seen on social media is, when are we going to be together? And that's something in front of us and something that we need to look at. Now, I'm back on preaching through the lectionary, so we're going to look at two passages. We're actually going to look at all three. This is the fourth Sunday after Easter, and it's so funny how God lines things up to give us the words and the principles and the messages that we need. So we're going to look at a couple of passages that talk about togetherness and actually what holds us together, because the sermon I've entitled is Together Wherever. Now, I miss our members. I miss seeing them come in the door. I miss the hugs. I miss the conversations. We love our gathering places. But I hope by the end of this message, you realize if you're a born-again believer in Christ, you are a walking sanctuary. The Word says that the Holy Spirit resides within us. And so we can actually be together. I said last week, I heard the story of a father who was so glad to be doing church online because his two kids were in different states, and he could go to one service and virtually be in church with his children that he'd never experienced before. So they were experiencing together wherever. But we're going to look at how the first followers, the early church, so viewed the art of being together and how deep it meant to them. Acts chapter 2, we're going to read verses 42 through 47. I'm in the New Living Translation. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, and to fellowship, and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. So they devoted themselves to four things, and we'll unpack that in a few minutes. A deep sense of awe came over them, all. And the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. And all of the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in their homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity. All the while they were doing all that we've read about, the scripture says, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. Some translation says they even enjoyed the favor of the city. And by that means this early group of believers, the church that was birthed earlier in the chapter at Pentecost, was loving and being together so much that the city took note of this new group of people. Wouldn't that be amazing if that broke out in this city or your city? We need to have that happen. All the while praising God, enjoying the goodwill of all the people or the city, and each day the Lord added to their fellowship those that were being saved. Notice who's doing the adding. I believe when you're doing what God's called you to do, God will send you the people He needs to do even more with. And that's what should be attractive to any church that's striving to be a Bible-led, kingdom-based church. And that's what we're striving to do here at Creekside, is to be that church. Let's jump to the New Testament. Let's hear the words of Jesus. John 10, 1 through 10. We kind of go from a group mindset to a single but group mindset, kind of speaking to us. Jesus says, I tell you the truth, anyone who sneaks over the wall of a sheepfold rather than going through the gate must surely be a thief and a robber. But the one who enters through the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep recognize his voice and come to him. You might want to underline, recognize his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. Notice he doesn't drive them out. A good shepherd is ahead of the sheep, leading the sheep. After he's gathered his own flock, he walks ahead of them and they follow him. Why, Jesus? Because they know his voice. They won't follow a stranger. They will run for him because they don't know his voice. Those who heard Jesus use this illustration didn't understand what he meant, so he explained it to them. I tell you the truth, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me were thieves and robbers, but the true sheep did not listen to them. Yes, I am the gate. Those who come in through me will be saved. They will come and go freely and will find good pastures. The thief's purpose is to steal, kill, and destroy. I'll give you three guesses who the thief is. Satan. My purpose, Jesus says, is to give them a rich and satisfying life. That's the New Living Translation. Or an abundant life. Or King James, life to the full. It's so interesting that Jesus says that he is the shepherd, he is the gate. In olden times, if you haven't heard this story, shepherds had sometimes even a rock corral. If you're of Western influence, I grew up on a farm, and we had at one time 75 head of cattle. And when we had to vaccinate or tag the cattle, we drove them into a corral where we could control them. But in biblical days, to watch the sheep, because the most dangerous thing was the predators. And so the sheep would spend the night in either a self-built rock outcropping or maybe some wood or brush, but a good shepherd would actually lay across the entranceway so that no predator could come in. See, Jesus is not only our shepherd, he's our protector. And we're going to look at that. But let's unpack both of these verses together. So back to the Acts 2, the first followers were devoted to four things. Number one, the apostles' teaching. Well, what is that? It's what we're teaching today. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the words that they took from Jesus in the 3 years that they spent under his ministry guidance. It's repent and be baptized, and you shall be saved, and your sins will be forgiven, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. It's to confess the name of Jesus as the true and living Son of God. That is what the apostles were teaching. It's love one another. It's love God. And it's love your neighbor as yourself. It's esteem others more highly than yourself. It's bear with each other. It's confess your faults to one another. It's pray for one another. That is the apostles' teaching. That is what those first followers of the early church embraced. That is what the city was seeing, this totally new group of people together act out. Number two was fellowship. They liked hanging out together. They actually liked each other. They liked doing themselves. And from the Acts 2 passage, we see not only were they in the workplace hanging out, they were hanging out at their homes, but it also said they met daily. They didn't meet just every Sunday. They met daily at the temple. Now, you have to put it into context. Realize that the temple was the social gathering place. They're Jewish, obviously. It would be like going to the center. If you grew up in a small town in the South like I did, it would be like the courthouse. How many of you grew up there and you go down there and see those community characters sitting on benches whittling? You know, if you don't know what whittling is, you need to look it up. Or telling stories, sometimes exaggerating those stories. Down from my house, we had a true traditional country store with two gas pumps out front. And as I got to be 9, 10, and 11, I wanted to go to the store, obviously, for, you know, drinks and candy and stuff. But they, too, had a lot of older men that would sit out there. And as I got a little 10, 11, and 12, Mom didn't like me hanging at the store because some of those stories those men told was not suitable for teenage years. They were increasing my maturity. But we all in our cities and communities have gathering places. And these first followers, it was normal for them to go to the temple. But they weren't going to the temple to be ritualistic in their Jewish faith. They were going to together because they liked the fellowship. I'll tell you, as a pastor, and we're blessed here at Creekside, I love to see spontaneous get-togethers. I love to see, said, hey, yeah, we had all the young adults over at our house and we had board game night. Or, yeah, we went out to the park after church and we had a picnic meal and we threw frisbee. I love to see fellowship happening outside the walls of this building. Oh, it's wonderful to come here every week and hug on each other and love on each other. But the first followers had it down. They loved being together 24/7. And what would that look like for us as Christians? What would that say to the unbelieving people in our lives and around us? Part of that fellowship was the third thing that the Scripture says. They were sharing meals. Isn't it great? Who doesn't love? I mean, I know some of us have stressors and family that stress us, but think of Thanksgiving, think of Christmas, think of special meals where you've sat down at a table with people you love. And the interactions that happen there, it's sweet, it's deep, it fills our vessel. Not only did they just eat together as meals, they took what the apostles gave them, what Jesus gave them. Jesus gave it to the apostles that last night at the Last Supper. But they shared a communion feast. They remembered the death, the burial, and resurrection. That's why we commemorate it today. But they loved hanging out in each other's homes. They loved sharing meals together. They loved doing communion together. And last but certainly not least, the most powerful thing they did was prayer. Remember, this is a group that we will read about in Acts that pray so hard the building shook. When's the last time you prayed that hard, church? When's the last time you prayed so hard you heard a mighty rushing wind? When's the last time you prayed so hard that someone in prison walked out with an angel outside of prison? See, when we have the bonds of Jesus' love so deep and so rich together, it doesn't matter if we're scattered. It matters right now. Can I tell you this minute? Hallelujah, glory to God. Right now, the church is meeting worldwide. Across the nations, across the oceans. And it's all coming up before God the Father as one beautiful sound to Him. Because that's how it's going to be one day for all of us who've placed all of our hope, trust, and faith in Him in a place called heaven in eternity. But not only those four things, not only the apostles' teaching, the fellowship that they had, the sharing meals and communion and prayer, here's some other things we need to take note of. Notice this, and I truly this is in context. Notice that miraculous signs and wonders came after they devoted themselves to those four things. You know, in Jesus' day, some came to him and said, hey, if you're who you say you are, show us a sign. And he said, I'll show you anything you want, but you still won't believe. But notice when you're devoted into the Word of God. Notice when you're devoted to loving one another like you biblically should. Notice when you're devoted to loving your brothers and sisters in Christ in your local community. And notice when prayer goes ahead of things, you may see some miraculous signs. I've seen miracles. I've got three of them living in my house when my children were born. And you say, well, that's nature and that's true, but the miracle of birth is still a miracle. But I also have had friends who have gone into a doctor's office, got the word they did never want to hear that, yes, that's a lump and it's cancer, and the church prayed and the x-ray showed different. And I'll just say for me, if that's not a miracle, some may, you know, naysayers may say, well, they just misread it. Well, maybe they did. But maybe God just removed it. Amen? We have to trust His power. Second, they met in the temple and in their homes. Like I said, I pray when we come back together, physically meeting, we don't limit ourselves just to having to meet on Sundays. That we, as the body of Christ, meet together as brothers and sisters of Christ all over the city, out of our workplace scenarios, out of our extracurricular time that we have to do our hobbies and interests. They were kind and neighborly and shared everything to those in need. You talk about benevolence department, the early church had it. Anyone that had a need, it even says that some people sold property. Could be physical property, could be land. But in this early group of believers, they so loved Jesus and they so loved each other that no one went hungry. No one went having to back pay the rent. They met the needs of their group, of their family. And I love this last one. They were continually filled with gratitude and praise. Is our lifestyle that? Do people see you as a person, as better yet, do people see you as a Christian who has a life of gratitude, an attitude of gratitude, as we say, and that you're always praising God, whether you're on the mountaintop or whether you're in the valley? Because that's the life a follower of Jesus needs to display. And as a result, as we said, as a result of all these characteristics, as a result of all these things happening, the city said, what is going on with these people? And they loved what they were doing so that the city officials gave favor to them. We don't have the details of that, but maybe it looked like this. Maybe they allowed them another meeting place. Maybe they drew them into circles, or maybe they called them up and say, hey, we know you're the group that helps people. We have someone here in our city that needs some help. We have a widow that needs some help. Would your group be interested in that? I'll tell you, it's a wonderful thing to have the favor of the city you live in upon you as a group of people. And this special group of people would become what we know as the church. So the question that this would bring us to, hopefully, is how did this happen? How did this together wherever, how did this deep love, how did this fellowship play out? How was the early church, the first followers of Jesus, able to do these kinds of things? And I'll challenge us, why aren't we doing the same? Well, there is a common denominator. His name is Jesus. The early church embraced the core pillar of the apostles' teaching, and that pillar of the apostles' teaching is Jesus was their good shepherd. And he knew them by name, And he spoke, and they heard his voice, and they didn't listen to all these other static voices out there like there are today. If you don't believe that, get on Facebook and look at a reopening thread and see all the comments. You can find any opinion you want. Pick one. And you'll see inner arguments in between those. There's a lot of voices out there. Should we do this? Should we do this? Is it a conspiracy? Is it an act of God? It's all over the board. The only voice as a follower of Jesus you should be listening to is Jesus. So here's our scripture. But the one who enters through the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep recognize his voice and come to him. He calls his own sheep by name. Mark, Mike, Michael, Will. And we hear it, and we react to it. And he leads them out. And after he's gathered his own flock, he walks ahead of them. And they follow him because they know his voice. They won't follow a stranger. They will run for him because they don't know his voice. So that brings us to ask, if we really want to be that community, if we really want to be like the first followers in the early church, we have to ask ourselves this question. Is Jesus the good shepherd of our life? Are we looking to him as the good shepherd? Are we looking for him to lead us through troubled times? Are we looking to him to lead us through green pastures? Are we looking for him to protect us from the attacks of the world? I want to read a passage you know. If I ask you to recite it, you could recite it with me online. This group here at Creekside could recite it. It's the 23rd Psalm. Many of us memorized it in church. Used to be you even memorized it at school if you're my generation. But I want to share a translation. I love Eugene Peterson. He wrote the translation of The Message, and he sometimes has such a beautiful way of phrasing things with certain biblical passage. And I hope this is a first for many of you. I hope that many of you have never read the 23rd Psalm from The Message translation. And I ask you to really turn to it in your Bibles or listen to the words and listen to the feeling behind Peterson's Message translation of the 23rd Psalm, because this frames Jesus as our good shepherd. God, my shepherd, I don't need a thing. You've bedded me down in lush meadows. You find me quiet pools to drink from. True to your word, you let me catch my breath and send me in the right direction. Even when the way goes through Death Valley or a pandemic, I am not afraid when you walk by my side. Your trusty shepherd's crook makes me feel secure. You serve me a six-course dinner right in front of my enemies. You revive my drooping head. My cup brims with blessing. Your beauty and your love chase me every day of my life. I'm back home in the house of God for the rest of my life. Do you know Jesus is a shepherd like that? Do you know his love and beauty? Do you know his cares and concern for you this morning? Is he the good shepherd over your life to get you in the right direction, to keep you from harm? You see, when Jesus becomes our good shepherd, when we listen and follow him, and when we devotedly listen and follow him, this is how we can be together wherever. There are people that have Jesus as their good shepherd on the other side of the world right now. There are people here in the far parts of the cities that's never been in this building, but Jesus is their good shepherd. And when we listen and follow and know his voice, we're not only given the great privilege of being able to be together wherever, one day we'll be together forever. And that's the promise and blessing of God. So I ask you this morning, church, do you know Jesus as your personal good shepherd? Is he Lord of your life? If not, if this is your first time hearing this, I'd ask you to just bow your head in prayer. Ask Jesus, talk with him. Confess him as Lord, as Romans says. Confess that he's the true and living Son of God. And find a place and make the next commitment of faith. Be baptized in his name, as we said, for the remission of sins and to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit so he can empower you to live that abundant life he's calling you. And not let the thief come in and kill, steal, and destroy, because that's what the devil wishes to everybody, to just mangle their lives. And then find you a Bible-believing church that lifts up the name of Jesus, that is kingdom-focused, and become part of that community, like those first followers, like those early believers in Acts chapter 2, that can encourage you, that can walk with you, that can support you, that you can laugh and cry with, and you can have an extended spiritual family. I'm going to pray for you now as we close, and then we're going to have communion together like the early church did. Pray with me. Father, it's an amazing thought, and even more an amazing privilege to know those of us who have pledged our hearts to you, those of us who have responded in obedience to your invitation to become your children, to become followers of Christ, that, Father, by your Spirit, we can be together forever. Even if it's personal blood family, even if it's friends coast to coast, by our belief in you, you connect us. Jesus, you are the common denominator in the heart of the believer. Jesus, you are a good shepherd. Father, I'm just moved to pray for someone who might be listening to the stranger's voice this morning, who might be bombasted with all kinds of false information and lies from the evil one, and they're trying to find you. God, would you just reveal yourself to them this morning? Would you whisper their name in the most beautiful voice ever to walk the earth and call them to a new life? Would you touch them right now for that person that needs to know you as a shepherd, that needs you to help care for them, that needs you to help lead them and protect them? And Father, would you continue this spirit first here at Creekside, that of how much we love each other and how much we love this community, by because of our love for you. And would you empower us, Father, to keep growing and let us find even more and more favor with this city to do things that you already want us to do, that is your will, that is your kingdom pushing forth, Father. Would you empower us in that? God, thank you again, just again, for the privilege of being together wherever. John, when he was exiled to Patmos, he had a worship service of one, and you showed up. Whether we're standing in a building of 300, 400, 1,000 people, or 20 or 30, where two or three together, Lord, you say you're right there in the midst. Thank you for that. Thank you for loving us more than we'll ever know. In your name, Jesus, amen. We do practice weekly communion here at Creekside Community Church. We continue the apostles' teaching, reflecting on it each week as a memorial feast to remember, as Jesus said, the death, the burial, the resurrection. I encourage you at home, to our families here at Creekside that are in their homes, we've told you, you can make this part of your worship experience, to where you can use grape juice, you can use wine, you can use fruit juice, whatever you have, you can use bread. But to remember the body and to remember the blood. I'm going to pray and then we'll take this Lord's Supper, this Holy Communion together. Pray with me. Jesus, thank you that one of the last things that you gave us in that upper room with your disciples, your apostles, was this memorial feast, this sacrament, this ordinance of the church to remember your body, the bread, and the cup holding the blood, and that we eat and drink of it worthily to proclaim your coming until one day you come and redeem us all. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to invite you to continue to follow us. If you don't have a home church, we certainly welcome you into our online community. We would welcome you when our reopening happens, and we'll be communicating that out on our public page and to our members as well, to be a part of that. Another act of worship we do is the act of giving. We believe that's a spiritual discipline, and we encourage our members to give. If you would like to donate, we have a digital app called Givelify, where it's real simple. It's one of the most user-friendly giving apps out there, where you can just go to Givelify and pick Creekside Community Church. And if the Lord leads you to make a donation, I assure you with all integrity, it will be used to further the mission of the kingdom of God here in Hot Springs to help people that need to be helped and to do the work of the Lord. I invite you during the week to check out, as Mikey said, Monday, Tuesday, Thursdays, and Fridays. I did change time. They'll be at 10 o'clock every morning. Just a brief word from the scriptures, about a 10-minute devotional, hopefully to encourage you on your day. And then Mikey and the praise team do an awesome job. Worship on Wednesdays, live at 5 in the middle of the week. If you need uplifting, tune in. And again, you can tune in Facebook Live, you can tune in our YouTube channel, or you can go to cometocreekside.com and check us out. We're going to close with the song, I Wish You Peace, this morning. I wish that if you don't know Jesus, you come to know him, if not today, but soon. And I wish for him to become the good shepherd of your life. Grace and peace. Amen.
Here and now, here and now, here in this moment, here and now, I turn to you. All that my searching heart has longed for can be found. 'Cause you're in this moment, here and now. What majesty, what mystery, the God of all eternity stepped into time, gave his life for me. Your hand is seen in galaxies, yet your spirit dwells in me, so vast, and yet you're still within my reach. Here and on earth could ever keep your presence out. turn to you. All that my searching heart has longed for can be found. 'Cause you're in this moment, here and now. You're in this moment, here and now. We have only one life, and it soon will pass. And only words done for Christ will last. Jesus, you can use me, Lord. Riches in houses, cars and land will pass away, but my life will stand. Can use me, Lord.
Lift your voice.
For your glory, for your glory, for your glory, you can use me. We have only one life, and it soon will pass. And only what's done for Christ will last. Jesus, you can use me, Lord. Riches in houses, cars and lands will all pass away, but my life will stand. Jesus, you can use me, Lord. Oh, Lord, yeah. For your glory, for your glory, it's for your glory, you can use me, Lord. Let our voices sing, we say yes, Lord. We say yes, Lord. We say yes. And it soon will pass. And only what's done for Christ will last. Jesus, you can use me, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Let that be our answer, our heart cry for for everyone in this room and everyone watching, that we say yes. And that we, when you call, Lord, and when you tell us who we are, we say yes. And we respond and we say yes, we believe, Lord. And then when that truth is planted inside and the enemy comes to call, we can't hear him. We only hear your truth, your dominant voice, your strong love, Lord. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Thank you guys for tuning in with us. Please connect with us throughout the week, and we will be here together wherever. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys have a good day.